Would you like to know why FinOps cannot solve the escalating cloud cost problem? If so, this video is for you. Hi, my name's Mike Gibbs. I'm an enterprise architect with approximately 25 years experience. Today, we're going to talk about something very important, why FinOps cannot and will never solve the cloud cost crisis. And why cloud architecture is really going to be the ultimate solution. And we're going to talk about what went wrong and how organizations can optimize their cloud spend, and then where FinOps actually fits in, because FinOps does play a role, but FinOps is more of a reactive problem. So we can either prevent the overspending in the first place, which is going to be the cheapest option, or what we could do is spend a lot of money and then hope to catch it with FinOps and then optimize it and tune it. And sadly, that's what most organizations do. So let's talk about why cloud computing usually will cost more expensive. Let's talk about where cloud computing may actually cost less, and how our cloud architecture, or the right cloud architecture, is really going to be the secret to optimizing our cloud cost. And then when we add FinOps in, then we've got some serious magic. So we have to understand the cloud computing business first. So cloud computing is a landlord-tenant model. And let me explain how that model works. The landlord buys something. Let's say it costs the landlord $1,000 a month, and then the landlord rents it to you, the customer, for, say, $2,000 a month. And that's the landlord-tenant business. And when it comes to cloud computing, it's exactly that business. So an organization has the option to build their own data center or rent a virtual data center, and that's all cloud computing is. So if you're not familiar with enterprise computing and you just got an AWS or an Azure certification, let's talk about what cloud computing really is. So in a traditional business, and as most businesses still have them, they take a building, they bring in a lot of power, they bring in a lot of cooling, they put their network in, their routers and their switches, they have a whole bunch of racks and servers and computers is placed in the racks, storage area networks are attached to the networks that are here, load balancers are put in, firewalls are put in, and for the most part, you've got a data center. Now, what does the cloud provider do? They do the exact same thing. But in this case, they build a much bigger building and they bring in more power and more cooling, and then they build a bigger network, and then they add more servers and more storage and load balancers, and then they add a little layer of software which enables them to rent that out to you. So if you view cloud computing as kind of like renting a room in a hotel where your VPC or your VNet is your room or your suite, you truly understand the cloud computing model. You could buy your own house and build your own house, or you could rent a room in a hotel or an apartment complex. And that is the nature, the multi-tenant nature of cloud computing. So now that you understand that, understand that the cloud provider not only has to build the same data centers that you do, they have to manage them at scale, which typically gets much more expensive than a normal organization, because as we get hyperscale, it needs more layers of governance. But it's not just that. They need to hire tens of thousands of highly paid salespeople and solutions architects, and they need a marketing department to go sell this, and a customer service and support. So operating a cloud provider is very expensive, and it's going to cost them a lot, because they not only have to run the same data center that you do, but they've got to sell it, market it, and all those kind of things. So understand, the only way a cloud provider might be able to do that is to charge you 3 to 10 times more in many cases than it would actually cost you to do it yourself. So wait, does that mean we should not be using cloud computing because the cloud is so much more expensive? Not at all. The secret is using the correct architecture, which is putting the right systems in the right place where we can maximize the performance and know where it's going to be cheapest. The second side of it is stringent architectural planning. We need to know the types of systems we have, the utilizations of those systems, the utilization of the network, what kind of things are talking to what kind of things, and how much data we're talking about. And in this manner, we can meticulously plan the architecture. Now, if we get sloppy and we just use tools that are automated that are just going to copy our virtual machines and databases, and we don't think about it, we're going to have no idea what our cloud costs are going to be until FinOps comes in after the fact, after we've spent too much money. So what do we need to think about? The cloud's strengths are that the infrastructure is already there. It's highly agile, which gives you speed to market of new services, for example. It's got incredible scalability. And for the most part, there are experts that are managing the system. So if companies don't have the best or access to the best and most talented technology people, most cases, the cloud providers already do. So the person who's going to rent space in that cloud provider is going to be managed more, and they're going to pay for that convenience. Here's the problem. Cloud computing can be 3 to 10 times more expensive for some workloads. So let's look at where the cloud is cheaper. The cloud is very efficient cost-wise for what you call intermittent workloads, things that either happen very little, happen infrequently, or today they're used a little bit, an hour later they're used a lot, and then they're used a little bit for the next few weeks, and then for a week they go big. So that kind of intermittent computing in the data center, we have to build it for maximum use for the most part, and it gets expensive to do that because we reserve compute capacity we may not be using most of the time. In the cloud, this is the kind of thing we put on the cloud. We purchase as little compute as possible, and then we scale in and scale out as needed. That's typically very cost efficient for the cloud. Event-driven systems. If this happens, then do something else, often much cheaper in the cloud, because in a normal environment, if we wanted to have something that was watching for something to happen, to take an action, we'd have to pay for that compute all the time. On the cloud, we can use some flavor of a functions as a service for an event-driven architecture, like an Azure function or a Lambda function, and we only pay for it when it runs. So intermittent sporadic applications, event-driven things, the cloud is very cheap. Now, also on a website, we can often be cheaper on the cloud, especially if it's a retailer that's web servers might run at 5% utilization all year and be at 95% during the Christmas holiday type season where people tend to buy a lot. And if that's the case, maybe that organization doesn't have to buy for peak. They can just pay for average on the cloud and then use auto scaling during that season. Again, that can provide some cost savings, those types of workloads. Now, here's where cloud computing is terribly expensive. High volume, high performance compute. And I'll give you an example. I can go to Dell right now and buy a server with about 384 cores with these AMD EPYC processors, which are hugely powerful. That's physical cores, about 6 terabytes of DRAM and about 100 terabyte NVMe RAID array in that server. Now, I can get that for about $300,000, but to run it in the cloud over 4 years on demand, that's going to be about $5 million, so 15 to 16 times more. Now, if I've got a company that needs 100 of these servers, the cost of these servers might be $30 million. Even if I need an additional $50 million of infrastructure to run them, which I don't, my cost is about $80 billion in the data center for those kinds of servers. Now, what do these servers cost in the cloud? About $500 million as opposed to the $50 to $80 million in the data center. That doesn't make sense to put it in the public cloud. Storage is another place where the cloud is often much more expensive. But not always. So, but the cloud also typically offers immutable storage, which can be very good for prevention against ransomware attacks and other things. So depending upon where we use it and how we use it, it can be cheaper or more expensive. And I'll give you another example where the cloud could help us and where it might make sense. So let's say we've got an AI workload that in a data center takes 100 NVIDIA GPUs to run all the time. But we really need 10,000 GPUs to train our model for 3 weeks straight or 4 weeks straight. Well, maybe we rent the 10,000 GPUs from AWS or Azure for the whatever time we need to train the model, do that in the cloud so we didn't have to purchase all that. And then we run it the systems in our data center. So we can do things like that, and there's nothing to preclude us. And in one of the cases, some of the cheapest options is what's called cloud bursting. And cloud bursting is we run the workload in our data center, and when the workload reaches a certain percentage of utilization, it immediately kicks in on the cloud. And then and that way we add capacity when we need it without even paying for it ahead of time. So there's a lot of opportunities that we can optimize our architecture as long as we plan for it properly, knew what our capacity was, knew what our application utilization patterns are, and then we can figure out where the right workload is. Now we can put our systems in the right place. We can optimize the systems we're purchasing initially, and that's going to be the key to really reducing our cloud costs. And then as we're running on the cloud, this is where the FinOps people come in. And they're looking and saying, okay, something here, something here, something here. And then FinOps keeps reporting back into the business, and the business and the architects will evaluate this and say, okay, do we need to change the architecture, adapt the architecture? Where's the business going? Should we change something? And that way, this kind of collaboration going back and forth, where first we design it right, and then once it's operating, the people that are there operating it look for the cost and look how to optimize it. That's the secret to the cloud cost, to put the workloads where they are, make sense. And whether that's in a community cloud, a co-location facility, a private data center, a private cloud, like a data center running Nutanix or OpenStack software, or even VMware software for that matter, it really doesn't matter. That's the secret. If you'd like to become a cloud architect or a solutions architect or an enterprise architect or an AI architect, please join us on a free webinar. We have webinars on how to become an architect, what we do in these various architectural roles. We'll go over the roles, all the skills you need to learn. And they're all completely free. Join us on Zoom and we'll answer any career questions you may have about these roles or anything else on these free webinars. If you've enjoyed this video, please give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and hit the bell to be notified of new videos to assist you in your technology career. This is Mike Gibbs signing off for now, and I look forward to seeing you in another video. Take care.